Worldwide Pinhole Photography Day is coming up, so we're gonna build an 8x10 pinhole camera for it. Hey fellow photographers, what did you photograph today? So Pinhole Photography Day is coming up. It's always the last Sunday in April, and it's a good excuse to go out and make some images and try something that you haven't tried before. And we're gonna be building an 8x10 version of this camera. I built this camera about 2 years ago. Obviously a 4x5 camera accepts 4x5 film backs. So now we're just gonna make one that is twice the size. And I'll kind of have a disclaimer. I'm not a woodworker by any means, but this is a pretty simple design. And as long as you have some of the right tools, some woodworking tools, a way to cut wood, I think you're gonna have a pretty easy time. It's a very simplistic design, so let's kind of go over what the design is, and at the end of this video I'll put up some screenshots of dimensions and plans, so if you want to mimic this design, you are more than welcome to. It's a very cheap and affordable way to make an 8x10 camera. It does use a pinhole. The budget for this build is between only $50 and $75, so it's a lot cheaper than a lot of other options that are on the market commercially. And you have the added benefit of doing something yourself and taking pride in your work, as well as using the science of photography. We're going to have an optimal pinhole design for this camera. So some other manufacturers, they may make pinhole cameras, but they don't necessarily adhere to those strict formulas to give you the sharpest image possible from a pinhole. So I've already cut these pieces of wood, and I'll kind of just take you through the basic design. Essentially, there are a bunch of 90 degree cuts, and they're joined in what is called a rabbet join. So essentially it's just four pieces here, and then there'll be a big face plate that will go here. We're gonna have to cut a large hole in this and then center our pinhole somewhere on this board, and we're gonna make sure that it lines up with the center of our film plane. In the last video I talked about how you can position the pinhole any which way you want, so you can get a little bit of a shift or, you know, side to side movement. We're not going to be doing that with this build. We're just going to do center to the film plane, which may not be necessarily the center of this board. But I'll take you through that exact process of how I calculate everything and figure out where things should go. So this face plate we're going to have to cut in. We're going to put a piece of sort of flat sheet metal and place a pinhole in here. So we're going to save that for later. And essentially it's just four pieces, four sides, right? And the key thing here is that we're not making just a box. We're making a box with some rabbet joins, like I said, which are kind of square joins that fit together a little bit better. And the whole purpose of this, if you just made four square pieces like you were making a box, then it's really possible that you're going to get light leaks. And the way this works is that the rabbet join kind of makes a 90 degree angle. So if light were to come in, it would have to come in through one of these, you know, gaps, make 90 degree turn, and then make another 90 degree turn to hit your film. So that's really not gonna happen with this kind of design. It just prevents a lot of light leaks. You could of course just build a simple box and then make sure you seal everything up, but this just gives us one added layer of security when it comes to only allowing light through that pinhole, which is so important. So like I said, it's four sides, and we're gonna go over the dimensions of these sides, but I'll just kind of give you sort of the skeleton view here. Essentially, there's a top piece. The top piece is a little bit special, so we're going to kind of hold off on this. But the three sides are all the same width here. And basically what happens is there's a left and right side, which are mirror images of one another. And then there's a base. And if you can kind of tell from this profile view, there is a 90 degree cut in each of these. So essentially it's just one big rectangle and then another smaller rectangle inside. So you get a piece of wood and then you just cut away these reliefs. And the way this works is that if we take a look at the base, essentially on the base, the two sides are 3/8 of an inch. And that's so that we cut these also to 3/8 of an inch. So they fit in very nicely, just like that. And the front is 3/4 of an inch because that's the thickness of the wood we're using for the front. So that's gonna be nice and flush up front as well. So that's the basic idea. I have to apologize in advance because the fact that we're using 8x10 film, which is obviously in inches, and then we're going to be talking about, you know, focal lengths and pinhole diameters and millimeters, so it's going to get a little confusing between the two systems, but hopefully not too bad. And here, the left and right side, like for example, the right side, on the right side towards the front of the camera, which I have this little arrow, so this is the front where the pinhole goes. The front, again, has to be that 3/4 of an inch to fit the front plate, and then the top is also going to be 3/4 of an inch because this piece, the top piece, is a little bit different. If you notice from the profile view, it's actually thick all the way through. Only on the front is where we're going to get the, if this is the top of the camera, it's going to fit just like that. So that cutout is 3/4 of an inch, but it's kind of just flat on both sides. There's no additional cutouts. There is one special cutout on the back, which is going to be a small little groove. And essentially, if I have my film holder handy, so film holders have a notch right there so that when you put the film holder in, like if you were going to put it in the back of this camera, it would sit securely in place. So that notch is essentially, this slit is going to line up exactly with that notch, so we get a nice and a light tight seal all the way around. Like I said, at the end of this video, I'm going to put up some sort of rudimentary schematics, and hopefully you'll be able to get an idea of what I'm talking about. But as far as wood goes, like I said, I'm not a woodworker, so I don't know really what I'm talking about, but a nice hardwood is what you want to go for. Nothing too soft, nothing like balsa wood or anything that's super, you know, usually some modeling materials are made out of balsa wood if you're doing modeling with wood. But we want something hard and rigid. We want something pretty sturdy because pinhole exposures take a long time. You don't want the wind to really shake things around. And this is a little bit easier to work with, I find. The hardwoods are easy to work with and cut. So a nice hardwood, this is red oak. And yeah, so all we have to do is cut these four pieces, cut the front, and then assemble it all together with some wood glue. And it's gonna be a pretty affordable project. So just a little bit more about the wood I'm using and what kind of pieces you can expect to buy. Essentially, you need a piece for all four sides that's at least as wide as whatever your focal length wants to be, plus about 25 millimeters or an inch. And the reason for that is it's going to be the width of this wood that determines your focal length. So this is the right side of the camera, and we have about 3/4 of an inch for the front plate, like I mentioned. And essentially this front plate, if this is the front of the camera, the pinhole is going to sit on this side, right? We're going to cut a big hole and then we're going to mount it from the back. So you're losing a little bit there. And then as far as the width goes, there's a little bit of a cutout here, 3/8 of an inch. And what that is going to do is that's going to allow there to be another sort of join here with the film holder. So we, again, we're trying to be as light tight as possible. So there we have another loss of focal length, essentially. But we do gain some because when you pull out this dark slide, there is some depth, this film holder, to the actual film plane. So if we, when you do all the calculations, the distance from the pinhole to the film plane, not necessarily the back of the pinhole camera that we're building, that distance is gonna be your focal length. So I chose a focal length of 80 millimeters, which is going to be super duper wide on an 8x10. It's the equivalent of about 11 or 12 millimeters on a full frame camera. And so if you're making your own or using these sort of plans as a guideline and you want a more normal sort of field of view, that would be about 150 millimeters, so almost twice this. So you need a larger piece of wood. So I cut these from 1x6 pieces of red oak. And what you have to know about wood sizes is that they quote a sort of nominal size, 1 inch by 6 inches, but the actual size of the wood is actually, for a 1x6, is actually 3/4 of an inch by 5.5 inches. So just keep in mind that there's a nominal and actual measurement to the wood that you use and that you buy, and make sure you base all your calculations off the actual dimensions of the wood. And the reason that this is sort of, the reason why I chose to recess these about 3/8 of an inch is just because it's half the depth of the wood. So this entire thickness is 3/4 of an inch. So half of that is 3/8 of an inch. So that's just made the math easy. Just go 3/8 of an inch all the way around. Now remember, it's the width of the wood that determines your focal length, but the length is pretty much governed by the dimensions of the film holder. So to make all four sides, you're going to need a piece that's at least 31 3/4 of an inch long. You might lose a little bit due to cutting. So to be safe, I just got a 3-foot piece of 1x6 red oak. And 3 linear feet, the price at the hardware store was $5.24. So that's $15.72 for this part of the project. And then I just got 1 linear foot of 1x12, same wood material. I just got a 1x12 by 1 foot long. This has already been cut down, so it's a little smaller than those dimensions. But that was $10.47, which brings our total to $26.19 so far for just the wood of the project. Not too bad. All right, so here are the dimensions for each piece, starting with the bottom. We're first going to cut a piece of wood 10 inches by 4 inches, and then cut halfway through the wood. Remember that depth of 3/8 of an inch. And we're going to leave a sort of interior rectangle that is 3/4 of an inch from the front and 3/8 of an inch from each side. For the left and right sides, we're going to cut a piece that is 11 1/4 inches by 4 inches. And now the left and right are going to be mirrored. So the left piece is going to have a 3/4 of an inch offset from the front and the left side. The other two offsets are 3/8 of an inch. The right side is just the mirror of that. So again, a 11 1/4 by 4 piece. The front is offset by 3/4 of an inch, and the right side is offset by 3/4 of an inch. The other two sides offset by 3/8 of an inch. Lastly, like I mentioned, the top is going to be a little bit different. The top is actually going to be 9 1/4 inches by 3 5/8 inches. So it's not going to be the same 4-inch width as the other pieces. Now I'll pause right there to explain why that is. So we'll take a look at this already built 4x5 camera as reference. You see how the film holder sticks up out of the top? Well, that means that the base is going to be one width and the top is going to be a little bit less just to accommodate the film holder. So the film holder sits in there nicely, and so we can make this groove. So that's why this piece is a little bit less wide. So just be mindful of that when you're building your camera. So again, once we have our 9 1/4 inch by 3 5/8 inch piece cut, there's only one offset on this piece, and that's in the front. And that's going to be another 3/4 of an inch offset, again, cut to a depth of 3/8 of an inch, which is half the thickness of the material we're working with. And then you're going to kind of have to eyeball the groove that you cut. It starts at about 1/8 of an inch, and it's probably, 3/16 of an inch thick or something. It really just, you cut out a little groove. You kind of have to work with your film holder in order to make the groove that goes and holds that in. Now the last piece is going to be the front face, which is 10 7/8 inches by 9 1/4 inches. And we're going to be drilling a big hole into this and doing a lot of other stuff, but it's a really easy piece to cut because it's just 2 cuts from your piece of wood. Make sure it's 10 7/8 by 9 1/4 inches. So now that you have all the dimensions, you should be able to cut these pieces from wood. And there's a lot of different ways to make these pieces. You can even actually get 2 pieces and glue them together. You can just cut the outer and inside rectangle here. That's going to be really hard to get square. That's why I tried to, sort of craft it from one piece of material for each side. And what I did was I used a table saw and I essentially made 4 cuts. So I put this face down with the blade going this way, and I made a series of 4 cuts on each edge. And then I would turn the piece sort of vertical 90 degrees, and then I would finish the cuts on all 4 of these edges like this to sort of chop off the rest of that material. So I'll put up some pictures of the intermediate process, the initial cuts I made. I'm not going to take you through how to work a table saw. If you're using power tools or anything sharp, obviously take all safety precautions, wear protective eyewear, anything safety related, please take very seriously when working with power tools. So I'll put up some of those pictures now. Now, if you had a router with a router bit, you can actually get a rabbit bit. It would be even easier for a router and a router table, because then you could just sort of line everything up and push it across the router to make these cuts. But I don't have a router, so I used the table saw and kind of made do with what I had. So now that we have all the building blocks of our camera, you know, we can kind of see again, if I start putting this together, everything should fit together fairly nicely. If I can balance it on the table. So all these pieces are going to go together like so, and then we're going to glue all these pieces together. We're going to drill our hole in the front, and we're going to position that with great care to make sure that that pinhole is exactly in the center of the image area. And I mean, this is the bulk of it. So if you have any questions about this process, if the diagrams are confusing or anything, or have any questions on what kind of materials you might need to build a different kind of camera, please let me know in the comments. This is going to be part of a sort of four-part series. This is part one, sort of assembling the base skeletal structure of the pinhole. Part two, like I said, we're going to go over the placement of the faceplate and the big hole and positioning the pinhole. Part three, we're going to be installing the pinhole and sort of go over some of the math of why I chose what pinhole diameter that I chose for this project. And then part four, after part three, we'll pretty much have a functional camera. Part four will just be some finishing touches, maybe staining the wood, making things look nice, putting these little guide pins in here, which I'll talk about. If you haven't seen my other videos on pinholes, you might not know what I'm talking about, but it'll all become clear very soon. Put these little hooks on here so we can strap some rubber bands across the back to keep our film in place. It's going to be a four-part series, and I hope you learn a lot. I hope it inspires you to make your own pinhole camera. And it doesn't have to be out of these materials, it doesn't have to be this design, but hopefully this serves as a great template and a good starting point for you to get into sort of the really magical world of pinhole photography. I mean, it's just a very, very tiny hole is capable of producing an image, and no lens is needed. It's really, really remarkable, and it's really sort of the where photography kind of started. The fact that you could use things like a pinhole or a camera obscura with a lens, and then finding a light sensitive material in order to sort of capture that image and preserve it so that it's there, it's tangible. So this is where photography all started, and things have come full circle, and I encourage you to go out on Worldwide Pinhole Photography Day and make some pinhole images. So until next time, when we start gluing all this together, it's going to be fun. So stick around, make sure you're subscribed to this channel, and until next time, as always, happy photographing.